chaos in American cities. We've seen protests, we've seen looting, we've seen riots, and now some people are calling for us to defund the police. Hey guys, welcome back to the DemCAD channel. I'm Reginald, also known as DemCAD. Absolute chaos in a lot of these cities. All right, I understand why people are upset over the death of George Floyd, but people are ignoring all the other deaths that occurred afterwards. I mean, what about that retired police captain in St. Louis, David Dorn, who spent 38 years serving his community, murdered while protecting a friend's business, a friend's property? Okay, you're not gonna see his face on a lot of t-shirts. People like that aren't really celebrated. But he spent 38 years protecting his community and he died doing so, even as a retired officer. Speaking of St. Louis, over the weekend, there were 21 shootings. 21 people got shot over one weekend, just last weekend. 6 people died. In Chicago, they had 18 deaths, 18 murders in one day. Sunday. One day. 18. That's what's going on in a lot of these areas. I came across this audio of the mayor of Chicago talking about, she was talking about the situation in Chicago, and basically this ombudsman, Alderman, was talking to her about the situation. He was concerned about the criminals taking advantage of the situation if she didn't really act, and it really got ugly in the recording. And I'm just thinking, you know, I don't know how many people live in Chicago who don't legally own a firearm, because now, just recently, they allow people to do that in Chicago, but it's really expensive to get that card, that firearm card, a firearm identification card. And the guy was concerned, the alderman was concerned that the criminals would start focusing their efforts, start targeting residents. And it's a recording I think you guys should really listen to. It's really interesting, to say the least. Now, what else is going on? In New York, Mayor de Blasio, he is now saying he's going to take away some funding from the New York City Police Department and move it towards youth and social services projects. And I'm thinking, okay, how is that going to make you more effective? Now, how's it going to make the police department more effective? This guy went on to say, quote, our young people need to be reached, not police. And we can do this and keep the city safe. End quote. Well, based on what he's been doing so far, I'm not really so sure he can really do that. I think, yes, young people need to be reached, but sometimes they also need to be policed, because we have young people out there who have been raised in environments where, you know, they haven't been taught morals or anything, and they are involved in criminal activity, and you have to police them. That's a real issue. In Portland police chief resigned. Jamie Reach, she resigned after a letter was published by a bunch of black community leaders in Portland. They're saying that, well, they don't like the fact that the police command structure is all white. I've never been to Portland. Doesn't surprise me. I mean, it's Portland. I've never been there. Let me put it this way with law enforcement. You're always gonna have white people overrepresented in law enforcement because there's more interest from white people to get involved in law enforcement. That doesn't mean that, you know, that there's some type of, you gotta have black people there to have an effective law enforcement command. And basically this police chief is stepping down so that a black person can take her spot. I'm thinking, you know, just because you put a black person in the position doesn't mean that the situation is necessarily gonna get better. I mean, how does that person think? I don't care about the skin color. What type of policy, what type of strategy does that person really have? That's what really matters there. You know, you can have an all-black command structure there. That doesn't mean that you're gonna have a better situation for the people. All right, you can have a black person in the White House. That doesn't mean that that person's gonna implement any meaningful policy changes or actually sign some bills that's gonna have a meaningful impact on the lives of black people. We've seen examples of that throughout many black cities, a lot of cities with black people and certain black leaders get in place and nothing really changes. Because, you know, the mindset's still the same. All right, different skin color, same idea, same mentality. Anyway, in Minneapolis, George Floyd's death has led to a lawsuit against the police department. There's gonna be some type of changes there. Now, what they're saying is they're gonna basically prevent chokeholds. They're gonna ban chokeholds, neck restraints, and things like unauthorized use of force. And also gonna set it up so that officers are required to report when people violate that policy. And I understand where they're coming from, but here's my thing about the neck hole, the chokes, and all this other stuff. If your life's on the line, you're going to do whatever it takes to stay alive. Now, I'm not saying that, you know, once you get a guy, once an officer gets a guy in handcuffs, that they should be putting their knee on their neck. No, or neck restraints, all that stuff. No, absolutely not. That's when you need judgment, good judgment to come in, okay? Now, if an officer is one-on-one fighting for his life, then I gotta understand the officer doing what he or she has to do to actually survive. I'm not knocking that person. I'm just saying when you don't have to do so, then yeah, you should be punished for doing something like that. But you know, that requires more effort and more training and all that other stuff. It's just easier for them to say, well, we're gonna have a rule change and that's it. I mean, and even if the person is a hand, because when the person has a hand on the officer's gun, you know, I mean, I think you should look at the situation, but the problem is, who's looking at each situation? Who's looking at the judgment? Who's judging the judgment of the officers? That's a bigger issue right there. Anyway, they're gonna ban a lot of crowd control weapons. Well, they're gonna still use crowd control weapons, such as chemical agents, rubber bullets, flashbangs, batons, all that stuff, but it can only be authorized by the chief or deputy chief. Okay, fair enough. Civilian body-worn camera footage analysis. So they're gonna have civilians looking at the body cam footage. First, you gotta make sure the officers are actually wearing it. Remember in Louisville when they had a situation with Breonna Taylor and officers went in, they ended up shooting her 8 times and they didn't have any body camera footage? You gotta have a policy where you're actually requiring people to do that. With that said, I understand why they want civilians to actually look at that. And because they don't want the police just covering each other's butts, basically. That's what we're trying to do there. So I understand the effort there, but what I don't understand is defunding the police. This defunding the police movement coming out of Minneapolis or whatever. A lot of people in the media point out Camden, New Jersey, they actually got rid of their police department and went with like a county police department. And they focus on community policing. Fine, that's something they want to do. But what's the plan here in Minneapolis? They have a veto proof. That means the mayor can't override it. A veto-proof majority is basically authorizing the dismantling of the police department. They're trying to defund the police department and their city council. The city council is actually pushing for this. Again, is this really the solution? Throwing the baby out with the bathwater. Look, focus on better policing. Focus on more effective policing. This is a pretty sizable city, okay? They got to actually come up with some, they got to actually get down and do some real work there. Not just, oh, let's just get rid of this police department, start over. Well, you can have a body of people who look into the police complaints and look for officers with an excessive amount of police complaints and especially the quality of them, and see if there's some bad officers that need to be taken out of the force. You can invest in some real practical training as far as hand-to-hand, as far as hand-to-hand combat, or as far as restraints and all that other stuff. Make the officers more effective so they're not sort of more comfortable with using other options other than lethal force. You know, lethal force, of course, when they need to, but just give them more tools to work with. Practical training, not the BS training. But, you know, it's hard to get real practical training. Those are some things on my mind. So, should we defund the police? I mean, what's the plan? Who's going to answer that domestic violence call? I mean, I'm not. I'm not being paid to get shot over some domestic violence nut stuff. No. Who's going to do that? All right. Bush and Cheney will not endorse Trump. Well, if I'm a Republican running for president, those are the last two people I want endorsing me. Jobs report. 2.5 million jobs were added in May. A phenomenal job report. 2.5 million jobs added in just 1 month. If you can believe it. If you can believe it. I hope it's true. I really do. I'm just ready for this whole nightmare to be over with. Thank you guys for watching. Thank you for listening. And don't forget, the future belongs to those who prepare for it today. All right, here's an update on the murder of that former police captain, David Dorn. 24-year-old Stephen Cannon is being charged with his murder. Now, this guy was sentenced to 7 years for felony robbery. However, he did not go to prison, thanks to a program called Suspended Execution of Sentence. As a result, he was placed on probation in which he violated twice, and he still never went to prison. Now he's facing a murder charge, the murder of David Dorn. Of course, he's innocent until proven guilty.